Sometimes they're so burdened down with their own problems, they can't even encourage you. But sometimes, David said, I encourage myself.
Yourself. Sometimes you have to speak victory during the test, and no matter how you feel, speak a word and you will be healed. Speak over yourself and oh.
Come on, how many know that he's able? Amen. Come on, how many really know that the Lord is able? Come on, can you help us and put your hands together?
Ladies and gentlemen, please take your seats. Please take your seats. At this time, we will have introductions of the National Board of Directors and the SCF Trustees.
Ophelia Averett. Fred L. Banks, Jr. William Barber II. Gary Bledsoe. Barbara Bowling. Julian Bond. Karen Borkin-Towns. Roslyn M. Brock. Amos Brock Brown, Deborah Brown, Carolyn Q. Coldman, Cynthia Butler McIntyre, Donald Cash, William Cofield, James W. Crowell III, Michael A. Curry, Theresa A. Deer, Diedrich Doolin, Anthony R. Douglas, Edward DeBose, Hazel N. Dukes, Catherine T. Eglin, Scott X. Exdell, James Gallman, John Gaskins III, David Goatley, Jessica Butler Grant, William H. Graves, George Gresham, Ron Hassan, General Holyfield, Aloya Horn, Antashe Howard, Alice Huffman, Leonard James III, Howard Jefferson, Ernest Johnson, Thomas L. Callahar, Daquan Love, William Lucy, Bob Lydia, Lamel McMorris, Lorraine Miller, Brindian Mitchell, Gwen Moore, Ariana Noble, Adore Oba Nwezi, Dennis V. Proctor, Mady A. Robinson, Stephen Ricard, Anita L. Russell, Leon Russell, David N. Saperstein, Julius Scruggs, Leonard Springs, Gloria Sweetlove, Oscar S. Tillman, Jesse H. Turner, Jr., Michael T. Turner, Joshua Turnquest, Yvonne White, Robin Williams, Lily Wilson, Richard G. Womack, Pamela Alexander, John E. Arredondo, Laura Blackburn, Larcine Bland, Zafar J. Brooks, Barbara Seb Davis, Kevin Dedner, Georgette Dixon, Angela Dorn, Eugene J. Duffy, Miguel Fostero, Ed Foster Simeon, Johnny Furr Jr., Patrick Gaston, Gerald Hudson, Roger D. Johnson, Thomas L. Callahar, Tanya Leah Lombard, Larry Lucas, Marcella Maxwell, Nate Miles, Keith Norman, Eric Peterson, Dwayne Proctor, Lonnie Randolph, Julia Felix Sessoms, Louis Schomer, Esther Silver Parker, Stephanie Silverman, Hilton Smith, Ralph Smith, John Spinato, C. Lois Steele, Roy Levi Williams, Kathleen Wilson Thompson, Sharif Yusuf Zaire, Carol Young.
Good evening. It is with great pleasure that I salute you this evening. You, the delegates to this, the 105th Annual Convention of the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People. My name is Leon W. Russell, Vice Chairman of the National Board of Directors of the NAACP and Chairman of the NAACP Convention Planning Committee. It will be my great pleasure to act as your presiding officer this evening. Joining me as parliamentarian is Ms. Ariana Noble, member of the National Board of Directors from Oceanside, California. I want to thank our outstanding choir for that rendition and welcome that you received coming in. In addition, as we go through this week's convention, we will be joined by our permanent convention musicians, the Reverend Ronald Terry of Macon, Georgia, and Larry King from Mobile, Alabama. Reverend Terry has been with us for a number of years, and many of you will recognize him as our great artist on our Hammond B3 organ. And Mr. King joined us last year, and we're fortunate to have him back with us. Ladies and gentlemen, for the first time in its 105-year history, the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People is convening in Las Vegas, Nevada. History tells us that what is now downtown Las Vegas became a reality when a parcel of land was actually auctioned off on May 15, 1905. The city was incorporated in 1911 and became a popular railroad town. The legalization of gambling in 1931 led to the advent of the casino hotels, for which Las Vegas is obviously famous. Today, Las Vegas is the largest city in the state of Nevada, 28th most populous city in the United States, according to the United States Census. Las Vegas has a population of over 500,000, 65,000 of whom are African American. Now, for 105 years, NAACP members have given their resources, their time, their energy, and in many instances, their lives in the pursuit of equality and justice. Those folks were truly all in for justice and equality. And we come to Las Vegas this evening all in for justice and equality. For some perspective, since this is the first time we've come to Las Vegas, you should know that the Las Vegas branch was first chartered in 1928. The officers and folks who have served over the years have actually made great contributions to our association. Lou Bertha Johnson served as the branch president and started Operation Independence, an anti-poverty program. Woodrow Wilson, the first elected black legislator in Nevada history, served as president of this branch during the 50s and 60s and started the West Side Credit Union. Dr. William H. Bob Bailey, a civil rights pioneer in Las Vegas entertainment and broadcasting industries, established training programs for blacks. J. David Hoggard Sr., who served as Las Vegas branch president in the mid-50s, and his executive committee represented the diversity of Las Vegas. They were a rabbi, black and white females, white men, and workers from all economic strata. Dr. Charles West, the first black to take the Nevada State Board of Medicine examination, the first black medical doctor in Southern Nevada, the first black surgeon on the staff of Southern Nevada Medical Center, and the publisher of the Las Vegas Voice, the first black paper that received national recognition for its fight against segregation was a president of the Las Vegas branch. Dr. James McMillan, the city's first African-American dentist, founder of the Las Vegas Human Rights Commission, the first black to serve on the state Democratic Central Committee, was a president of the Las Vegas branch. So as you see, this branch has a history that is a reasonable and legitimate part of the NAACP history. Interestingly enough, one of the other great accomplishments of this branch was something called the Moulin Rouge Agreement, an agreement that integrated this city, the hotels here, and the working environment. This branch has always been all in for equality and justice. And so, it is my pleasure to say that the NAACP has come to Las Vegas. We are here to let the world know that we affirm that in spite of the efforts to say that the NAACP is no longer relevant, we are here. We are all in for justice, and we ain't gonna let nobody turn us around. And so, ladies and gentlemen, it is indeed my pleasure to call the 105th Annual Convention of the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People to order. Would you please stand for the invocation, which will be provided by Reverend Don Burse, Senior Pastor, One Body in Christ Church, Las Vegas, Nevada.
Let's pray. Father, we bless you for being who you are in our lives. We thank and praise you for this day and all that we've already enjoyed. Father, we bless you so much for this opportunity to have this body of great people to travel from close and from afar for such a special purpose, to bring such a powerful meaning and purpose and an appointment to this city. I pray for every presenter tonight. I pray for every person who's going to sing. I bless you, God, because in spite of what we've been through, we still can look at ourselves and say proudly that you are still an awesome God. Out of all the highs and the lows and the shortcomings that we have, you still are an absolutely awesome God. I thank you, God, that and after 105 years, the purpose and the vision has not died. We've been through hard trials and hard storms, but God, you have made it possible that we be here tonight. Now that we're here, we're going to praise you, and we won't be ashamed. We're going to give you glory on purpose. We're going to agree, God, that you're still God, and beside you there is none other. We believe you for it. We trust you for it. In Christ Jesus' name, every believer, say amen.
Would you please remain standing for the posting of the colors by the United States Air Force Color Guard from Nellis Air Force Base here in Las Vegas. And following that, the playing of the national anthem and the singing of Lift Every Voice and Sing, led by Mr. Ken Young of Las Vegas. The posting of the colors.
lift every voice and sing till earth and heaven ring. Ring with the harmonies of liberty. Let our rejoicing rise high as the listening skies. Let it resound loud as the rolling sea. Sing a song full of the faith that the dark past has taught us. Sing a song full of the hope that the present has brought.
Thank you, Mr. Young. You may be seated. Delegates, please turn off all cell phones and pagers. That pagers is a reference to an older era. And be courteous to your fellow delegates. Tonight, we want to encourage everyone to download the NAACP Convention Act. There have already been 940 downloads. This download to your phone or your iPad will allow you to keep up with all of our convention events. You may also join the NAACP Convention Alert by texting NAACP 105 to 62227 to opt in to receive special convention alerts, changes, and to play along with our inaugural convention scavenger hunt, which takes place in our exhibit hall. Ladies and gentlemen, fellow delegates, it's my pleasure to introduce two video greetings this evening. These are important, and I would ask that you give your attention to our video screens.
Hi, everyone. I'm Senator Harry Reid, senator from the state of Nevada, and I'm also the majority leader of the United States Senate. Welcome to Las Vegas and the 105th annual NAACP Convention. I extend a special welcome to your incoming president, Cornell William Brooks, interim president and CEO, Lorraine Miller, national board chair, Roslyn Brock, vice chair, Leon Russell, and my friend of many, many years, Hillary Shelton. Hillary does a great job for you in Washington. I am so glad he's my friend. I can look to him for advice. He doesn't always tell me what I want to hear, but I am certainly grateful for the advice that he gives me. I trust his judgment. I commend the NAACP for their work in fighting for social justice, civil rights, economic equality, and you've done it for the last 105 years. Now, I just finished reading Devil in the Grove, an award-winning book about the NAACP and Thurgood Marshall. What an eye-opener it was for me. These horrible problems that have gone on in years past were happening not so long ago. And this book is so good, was such an education for me. Your goals of eliminating race, prejudice, ensuring political and educational and social and economic equality for minority groups in the United States have long been fought and continue to be echoed as we fight in Nevada, fight in the country, and especially the United States Senate, for a fair shot for everybody. I remain committed to safeguard voter freedoms that your members have fought for throughout your entire history. The United States Senate Judiciary Committee has committed to working with the NAACP, and they've done it, and others, on a plan to alleviate voter intimidation, which has really picked up the last few years. I intend to do everything I can to make this legislation a reality. Removing barriers of discrimination is so very, very important. And we share concerns of disparities that are occurring as we speak in economics, healthcare, education, voter empowerment, and the criminal justice system. I wish I could be with you today, discuss ways together, moving forward together. But my duties here in Washington prevent my being in Nevada. Have a great convention. Come back next year.
Hi, my name is Dean Heller, and I represent the great state of Nevada in the United States Senate. I'd like to welcome you to Las Vegas and for the 105th annual NAACP convention. With the 50th anniversary of the Civil Rights Act of 1964 having just passed, the timing of the convention could not be better. This landmark piece of civil rights legislation was enacted many years ago and continues to influence legislation today. At this year's convention, a full slate of events has been scheduled under the theme All In for Justice and Equality, with speakers and panelists coming in from across the country to discuss pertinent issues such as civic engagement, economic opportunity, education, and federal advocacy. The convention will promote the NAACP's goal of ensuring a society in which all individuals have equal rights without discrimination based on race. I hope you all enjoy your visit here to Nevada and wish you nothing but the best at this year's convention.
Let's thank both of those great United States senators for their welcomes. At this time, I'm very pleased to introduce Mr. Jim Murren, president of MGM Resorts International, based here in Las Vegas, Nevada. He will bring greetings to us from our host convention property and all of their sister properties. Mr. Murren.
Well, hey, everyone, are you having fun so far? You know, we're just getting going. I first want to share my welcome. I am so incredibly excited that you're here. I heard, by the way, you were in Orlando last year. Is that true? Oh, we got to do better than that, right? We can dial up our game a little bit better. You're in Las Vegas now. To Chairwoman Brock, to Vice Chair Russell, President Brooks, to all the board members, and everyone here assembled for the 105th convention of the NAACP, it is my honor as the chairman and CEO of MGM Resorts, on behalf of 62,000 men and women, to welcome you here to MGM Resorts and to Mandalay Bay, and to express to you how excited we are that you're here. It is stunning to us, as we work through this conference, to think about how honored we could be, how pleased and proud that you would choose to host your convention here. I'm, of course, proud as the chairman of the company because I want you to experience all that is great about MGM. All of our shows, our restaurants, going to all the fun things you can do and maybe get a little work done while you're here. I encourage you to have a blast. I can also say that you couldn't have picked a better place than Mandalay Bay. It is truly a great resort, world class. And I saw my colleague Chuck Bowling here. Chuck, where are you? Right there. Any problems, talk to Chuck. He's the president of Mandalay Bay right there. Stand up, Chuck. There you go. And Chuck, if that doesn't work out, I'm going to leave one of my business cards right here, okay? That's your get out of jail free card for Las Vegas. I also understand something quite profoundly. I know that it is truly a historic occasion that you would have your convention here in Las Vegas. We are acutely aware of the grim, hate-filled racial history of the old Las Vegas, when African Americans were not allowed to go to our shows, eat in our restaurants, much less work here. Because of the courageous work of the leaders you heard earlier tonight, such great activists like the late Dr. Bob Bailey, Ms. Ruby Duncan, Dr. Charles West, Dr. James McMillan, and many, many others, too numerous to name, those dark days are thankfully behind us. It was their collective contributions and sacrifices that have forever changed the face of Las Vegas. And the fact that you have chosen to have your convention here, the first time in over 100 years of your history, underscores once again that Las Vegas has indeed turned the page and moved into a new chapter. There's another reason why I'm so thrilled and honored that you would have your convention here. It was about 14 years ago that my company, MGM, voluntarily became the first in our industry to stand up and say we need to do more in the area of equality, diversity, in inclusion. No one told us to do it, no court order. We just knew it was long overdue and the right thing to do. Thank you. When we did that, and I was here for that, we reached out to you and your chairman then, Chairman Julian Bond, who is here tonight, and it was an honor to see you again, Mr. Bond. Thank you very much. And your wife. You agreed to help us. We knew we needed to learn. And because of you and your organization, you became our first diversity partner, a partnership that has thrived and, of course, continues today. Since that moment in time, we, of course, have become the absolute leader in hospitality for diversity and inclusion. We, of course, employ thousands of African Americans at every level, from board members to presidents of properties to significant executives in every step of our business. We have spent billions of dollars since that time with MBEs as we build our great resorts. We have spent millions in communities to help those that need that help. And we've been recognized for that. Just last year, Diversity Inc., which we've been on that list for quite a while, top 50 in the United States, named us the number one company, number one regionally in the United States for diversity inclusion. And I'm very proud of that. But that's not why we do this, of course. We do it because we all share a set of values and a commitment to that ideal of equality. And though we have made great strides in these several years, we cannot and will not rest. Like you, we recognize that our nation still faces, in too many ways, the toxic legacy of centuries of inequality. We can never stop. We can never stop to realize the reality that we can be a better country for this. We know that everyone deserves to have the opportunity to compete for a good-paying job. We know. We all have the right to be able to vote without interference. We know that we all have a right to pursue life, liberty, and happiness without the obstacles based on skin color or our place of origin. And we all have a role. I have a role, as do you. Companies like mine, organizations like yours, need to work alongside one another. We have a few sayings in my company, which I think are appropriate here. We are united through our diversity, and together we are better, and I believe that. So, I pledge to do our part. As a leader in our industry, as a host convention property for you and in our society, I know that challenges still confront us. I know that we can always do more, and so can MGM. And I promise to you that I will, as the chairman of MGM, do whatever I can. And I will, as the chairman of the American Gaming Association, bring my whole industry together for this very important quest. We know we can all work together better for this. So, thank you again. It is truly a tremendous honor for MGM Resorts to host your convention. We will do everything in our power, business cards included, to make sure that you have a productive an important convention. And remember this, that the works of this organization are so vital that in this case, what happens in Vegas should not stay in Las Vegas. Thank you very much.
That was a great presentation from a corporate leader, wouldn't you say? Now, I came out with the iPad because we are always joined in our conventions by folks who need to be recognized, who deserve to be recognized, and I wanted to make sure I had the list. So staff, very hurriedly, looked out here and saw who was important and decided to give us this list. To begin with, would you please recognize, and as I call your name, please stand, the Honorable Congressman Stephen Horsford, the 4th Congressional District of Nevada. The Honorable Congresswoman Marsha Fudge, the 11th Congressional District of Ohio. Is she in the house? They told me she was in the house. All right. The Honorable former president of a local branch of the NAACP, member of the venerable Spingarn Committee, stalwart on the CLE program, the Honorable Congressman Bobby Robert Scott, 3rd Congressional District of Virginia. My friend, Marty Castro, Chairman of the United States Commission on Civil Rights. Minister Ama Tutu Muna, Minister of Arts and Culture for Cameroon. Porsche Reddick Wright, Executive Assistant to Senate Majority Leader and Nevada Senior Senator Harry Reid. Joining us, I think, either now or later, we will have Anthony Anderson and Miss, now they didn't put it on here right, Miss Ellis Ross. Welcome all of you and thank you for joining us in this convention. Essential to our convention are the presiding officers and parliamentarians who will serve during the plenary and legislative sessions for the rest of this convention. I would ask that each of them will stand and be recognized. Judge Fred L. Banks, Jackson, Mississippi. Zafar Brooks, Fountain Valley, California. Amos Brown, San Francisco, California. Ron Hassan, Los Angeles, California. Alice Huffman, Sacramento, California. Nate Miles, Seattle, Washington. Ariana Noble, Oceanside, California. Mady Robinson, Florence, South Carolina. Louis Schomer, Santa Monica, California. And Oscar Tilbin, Phoenix, Arizona. Let's give them all a hand. For more than two decades, this association has presented the Medgar Wiley Evers Award to staff persons who have demonstrated dedication, competence, and commitment to the cause of civil rights and the work of the NAACP. It is a great honor for me to present Mrs. Catherine T. Eglin, member of the NAACP National Board of Directors, Gulfport, Mississippi, who will present the 21st Annual Medgar Wiley Evers Awards. Ms. Edglin.
Good evening. I am pleased to be here this evening to participate in this ceremony, which means so very much to the Evers family and to the NAACP. There have been many martyrs throughout history in every land and people and many high causes. Tonight, we pay tribute to another martyr in the crusade for human liberty, a man struck down in a mean and cowardly fashion by a bullet in the back, Medgar Wiley Evers, who served as field secretary for the NAACP in my home state of Mississippi from 1954 until his assassination 51 years ago on June 12, 1963. During his tenure, he focused on desegregation of higher education, the campaign against police brutality, the struggle for voting rights, and the campaign to desegregate the public accommodations. He was also on the front line in investigating and publicizing lynchings. I can think of nothing more fitting than this statement by his widow, Merle. She said, quote, "I am left without my husband and my children without a father. I am left with a strong determination to try to take us where he left off. And I come to make a plea that all of you will, by his death, be able to draw some of his courage and some of his determination to finish the fight. Nothing can bring Medgar back, but the cause can live on. It was his wish that this movement be the most successful one that the nation has ever known. We cannot let his death be in vain," unquote. In honor of Medgar's dedication annually, the NAACP recognizes three members of its staff, administrative, management, and executive, for their achievements, dedication, and commitment. As this award is presented, we commend you and urge each of you to continue to work to make the mission of the NAACP successful and to help assure that his death will not have been in vain. At this time, the first award will be presented to a member of the administrative staff. For the past 5 years, since 2009, this recipient of the Medgar Wiley Evers Award for Excellence for our administrative professional staff member has been employed as executive assistant for correspondence in the executive office. She has focused on the NAACP mission for equality and justice and has a comprehensive knowledge about its accomplishments, its current programs, and goals. She has been especially effective in assisting Dr. Thelma Daly with implementation of WIN, Women in NAACP programs, by working with the 7 NAACP regional coordinators to help them stay informed and carry on in the NAACP Game Changers programs within their regions. Sadie Harris also works with various departments to assure that requests from members and units are addressed promptly and accurately. For correspondence and communications from the president's office, she makes certain that the president's style, language, and positions are embodied without any question so that they conform to the official record. She also strives for excellence, which is reflected in her shorthand skills, written and verbal skills, her work ethic, her quiet manner, and her willingness to help anyone who is a part of the NAACP. According to her coworkers, she is most reliable and considerate and possesses a sense of spirituality which is calming, relaxing, and motivating to others with whom she works to move on to reach higher levels. Finally, the 45 staff members who nominated Sadie Harris concluded, "She radiates both inner beauty and outer beauty. She is a portrait of excellence." Now, I am privileged, and will you join me, along with the President, CEO, and the Chairman of the National Board, in presenting this award to Mrs. Sadie Harris, Executive Assistant, NAACP Executive Office.
Don't know what to say. I am totally, totally just shocked and surprised and so very, very grateful. I have to give all glory, all honor, and all praise to my Lord, my Savior, Jesus. I do what I do unto Him. I've been blessed at the NAACP, so very, very grateful. I know God placed me there. And you know, my prayer is always, Lord, you placed me here at the NAACP. Use me as you will for your glory, for your honor, for your praise. Thank you so very, very much.
Of the Management Staff Award currently serves as NAACP Southeast Region 5 organizer, our association's largest region, and has focused on training for using civic engagement to build coalitions and address relevant issues during non-electoral periods. As a result, new partnerships with other groups have been built on both local and state levels. These partnerships effectively work together for both electoral and issue campaigns. This training includes recruiting and training volunteers, voter registration, canvassing door-to-door, and planning and organizing. Because of extensive requests, she performs travel and training engagements to assist the regional director in completely fulfilling the extended schedule for the region. She led coalition building in Florida, bringing in 12 new coalition members to expand the implementation of Moral Monday, and develop plans for Florida, Alabama, and Georgia to continue their Moral Monday work to focus on counties with high rates of unregistered African-American potential voters. She has used her experience to create a training plan which includes the association's 5 game changers and has presented specific state versions in North Carolina, South Carolina, Florida, and Tennessee. We note that Rebecca previously served as NAACP Region 7 Director in 2011. During this time, she improved communications and relations with the national office, which had diminished while this position was vacant. She initiated weekly teleconferences on national programs, events, and resources. She worked with the region state conferences to form criminal justice committees, a new board-approved program. This included monthly teleconferences providing information and resources to strengthen the committees and identify expert speakers. In 2011, Rebecca also organized the first NAACP Criminal Justice Summit held in Chicago, which was attended by 30 state conference criminal justice committee chairs and leaders. In December of the same year, she trained over 200 volunteers of Connecticut, the District of Columbia, Maryland, and Virginia for the NAACP Civic Engagement, Education, Environmental and Climate Justice, Financial Empowerment, and Health Programs. Speakers from national and local organizations participated. Rebecca frequently represents the national office throughout Region 7, During her travels, she is known for taking numerous photos, which have been used by our national office in publicizing NAACP programs. She has received a variety of honors, including recognition by the Political Campaigning Master's Program at the University of Florida, also listed in NAACP Top 10 Future Leaders, and when she was named NAACP Region 7 Director, she became the first person of Latino descent to hold such a regional position. Her co-workers, or enthusiastic co-workers as you hear, emphasized that she is motivated, determined, and a vital part of the NAACP fight for equality and justice. It is with great pleasure that I present the Management Staff Award to Rebecca Guerrero, Region 5 Field Organizer.
First, to the members, to the Region 7 who was there when I started, thank you. To the mighty, mighty Region 5 who allows me to continue to do what I love each and every day. For all of the 6 a.m. travel, all of the 9 p.m. phone calls, it's worth it. Thank you so much. To the staff who continues to support me, particularly the field team, very much appreciate it. Thank you so much.
This year's award recipient in the executive category has served as NAACP General Counsel since November of 2010. Prior to this, she served as the 88th president of the National Bar Association, during which time she was a co-founder of the Legal Fund, which promoted law school scholarship for students of color. Collaborating with other civil rights organizations, she developed an expungement project to train local attorneys to assist ex-offenders with the process of expunging their records. Annually, each summer, she also assists in training new law students of color on civil procedure law and preparation for the demands of the legal profession. She has worked to promote the brand of the NAACP and was engaged in the revision of the NAACP Employee Handbook and Conflict of Interest forms. Additionally, she created the Charles Hamilton Houston Legal Fellowship in 2012 for new civil rights attorneys, which provides training on the job in civil rights and corporate advocacy. It should be noted that an immediate past fellow, who was also a Kellogg Fellow, now serves as Assistant General Counsel for the NAACP. New distribution and production contracts with TV1 have been negotiated for the NAACP Image Awards program as a result of Kim's work. The NAACP has also successfully negotiated a number of predatory lending cases with major banking institutions because of her work. Since there has been limited staff during the NAACP leadership transition, General Counsel Keenan worked to help ensure that the association's Daisy Bates Education Institute would succeed. She collaborated with the Board Education Committee, the Executive Events Planning, and Education Departments to appropriately complete this program. As General Counsel, she speaks out about the NAACP policies, positions, and programs in various sectors, including TV stations CNN, MSNBC, and Howard University radio station. She participates in a variety of entities which have programs compatible with those of the NAACP, such as the Lynx, a nonprofit group of women of color which focuses on ensuring the cultural and economic survival of African Americans. This year, she represented the NAACP as a speaker in Morocco to discuss judicial reform. She was also a member of a delegation to speak with representatives of major community-based organizations, groups, youth, and local political organizations in Kingston, Jamaica, concerning advocacy and influencing legislation for non-governmental organizations. Among the honors she has received are the Equal Justice Award from the University of Washington, D.C. School of Law and commencement speaker for the Howard University School of Law. The Washington Lawyers Committee for Civil Rights under the law awarded her the Wiley A. Brenton Award for Civil Rights. Kim's co-workers emphasize that she is able to bring a calming spirit with her to work each day, that her mantra for performing the work of the association, smarter, better, and faster, is poured into all the work produced by her office because she sets a prime example. She also acknowledges and appreciates the trail that was created before her. At this time, I am pleased to present the Executive Staff Award to Kim Keenan, NAACP General Counsel.
Wow. I want to thank God, because to be a lawyer from Buffalo, New York, and just be a never have known a lawyer growing up, and to get to put my fingerprints on this amazing work, it is an honor that's really difficult to explain. But the thing that gets me through when it's really hard is that group of people sitting over there. It is such an honor to get up every day and work with them. They are fabulous, you know, from Marshall to Lenita to Victor and Anson and Keela and Evan and Lillian and all my law clerks. My 7 law clerks are gonna take over the world, everybody. Halima. And not just the legal department. You know, what's really been great is that I get to collaborate with everybody, whether it's the executive office or the field or membership or IT or the Hollywood Bureau, which is part of my team, or the board office with the great Barbara Brown and Nicholas. It's just an honor to be with them every day. They serve you in ways that we couldn't even talk about if we wanted to. So I just want to say thank you to everybody. I want to say thank you to my husband for letting me drive 500 miles a week to go to work and fly away most of the time, and my son Jordan, who is sick. So anyway, thank you. I'm speechless, so I just want to stop while I'm ahead. Thank you.
At this time, the chair is going to remain with us for the purpose of making special recognition. Would you welcome to the podium Chairman Roslyn Brock?
Thank you, Vice Chair Russell. Good evening, delegates and members of the National Board of Directors of the NAACP. It is indeed my honor to be here with you this evening. My favorite passage of scripture is Jeremiah 29:11, "For I know the plans I have for you, plans not to harm you, but to give you hope and a future. For several months, or the last few months, there's been a lot of conversation about hope within the NAACP. But I'm pleased tonight to say that there is hope and there is future with the NAACP. And so it is my esteemed honor that I wanted to present to this delegate body a man who is and has been the association's pastor, preacher, for more than 30 years. Will you please join me in welcoming to the stage for a special commendation on behalf of the National Board of Directors and the NAACP, the Reverend Dr. Julius Caesar Hope. The office of the NAACP chairman and our president and CEO has many demands and responsibilities. And in view of this, it is a special and pleasant opportunity to acknowledge valued contributions and services performed by others. At this time, the president and CEO and I have the esteemed pleasure of paying tribute to such an individual and presenting this award to Reverend Julius Caesar Hope. The citation states, in recognition of dedicated and exemplary service in the ministry spanning over 40 decades, in salutation to exceptional leadership, serving as past NAACP Georgia State Conference president for 18 years and a branch president for 15 years, demonstrating effective skills and abilities which inspired renewed determination to support essential programs. Also, we of the NAACP proudly pay tribute to the 36 years of dedicated and exemplary work as the NAACP Director of Religious Affairs, during which vital partnerships with diverse leaders of faith across this nation have been established. It is therefore with admiration and much respect, sir, that the NAACP acknowledges these enduring contributions and offers an appreciation this well-deserved tribute. Behind us is a piece of artwork that is one of a kind that is in the archives of the NAACP. Only our most cherished, most valued, and most celebrated individuals ever have an opportunity to receive this priceless piece of artwork. Dr. Hope, we love you, we respect you, but most of all, we want to say thank you. Thank you.
Since I'm the National Director of Religious Affairs, let the church say amen.
Amen.
Let the church say amen again.
Amen.
Turn around and tell somebody, say, we ain't going nowhere. The Lord has brought us too far to leave us now. Say yeah.
Yeah.
You in church tonight, say yeah again.
Yeah.
Say yeah like it's Sunday morning.
Yeah.
Help me somebody. Proper protocol has already been established. But I want to just say to Chairman Brock that I appreciate her. We go way back. I know her when. But she has come forth and making a great contribution to our society and the nation. And we bless our children and children unborn. Brother Russell, our vice chair, I've known him eons. Always been a good friend, always been there when I needed him, always taking care of good business. And now we have a new president. Now I hear some folks saying, a new president, who know him, where he come from? What has he done? He's God's man. That's where he came from. God sent him to us for such a time as this. I wonder why we always try to predict what folk are before we even know them. Everybody needs to have a chance to prove themselves. He'll have my dying support, and always will, and you will too. I woke up early one morning, and I will not call any names, but it was said to me that I understand that you have changed over to other places. I said, what place is that? I said, no, I haven't changed. This is the brand that I will always follow. I am an NAACP. The Lord has brought us. And I'm ready and able. I'm not going to go anywhere. I'll be here until the Lord says, well done, thy good and faithful servant. I started some this morning, actually, in now, because I'm not the speaker. Y'all said thank you, Lord, because it's going to be a long speech. I can give some. And my man, Julian Bond, is he here? I just want to. He is a part of my background. While in Brunswick, Georgia, he did a minute mass meetings, led us through golf courses that had not been integrated, etc. But he's always been there. And I just want to let him know that as I take this honor, you are a part of it, because I couldn't have made it without you in those days. They said it's over for us. It's time for us to throw in the towel. We can't make it. We've fallen apart. I don't know where y'all got that from. Because I know better than that. I know the man who has the plan and the whole world in his hand. I know somebody who will never leave us alone nor forsake us. I know somebody who has brought us from nowhere to somewhere. And I know somebody, if we trust and never doubt, he will surely bring us out. And therefore, in order not to consume too much time, I just want to do what I did this morning. I want to recommend you to him who stood on nothing one day. Reached back through nowhere till he got something and brought something from nowhere to somewhere. Hung it on nothing and said, let there be light. That light came down through 42 generations, stopped by Bethlehem, born in a manger. They called his name Jesus, the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star, away out of nowhere. Do you know him? Have you tried him? If you know him, stand on your feet. If you know him, stand on your feet. Put your hands together. Tell him thank you. Tell him thank you. Tell him thank you. I trust in him because he has never failed me yet. I trust in him because he died on Calvary. But I come by to tell you, he got up early one Sunday morning with all power in his hand. And if you know him, say yeah.
Yeah.
Say yeah.
Yeah.
Say yeah. He's all right. I know he's all right because I've tried him. Hey, hey. I know you wish you could do that. Help me, somebody. May God bless you. May God give you. Let me, where's my son? Where's my son? This is my son. He's now assisting me under my circumstances. Everything is fine. He is now the pastor of New Grace Missionary Baptist Church, where his daddy served. My right hand.
Bless you.
Where's my sister-in-law? There she is. Ms. Elizabeth Hope, my brother's ex-wife.
No, not ex-wife, deceased wife.
Deceased wife.
No, deceased husband.
Deceased husband. See what she is. God bless you. We're on our way. We're going to make it as we have done over 100 years. We're going to come back stronger than ever. We're going to support this president, this board, and we're going to support and love one another and remember that together we stand and divided we fall.
Always good to recognize servants, and he is truly a servant. At this time, I'm pleased to welcome former Congressman Adolphus Towns of Brooklyn, New York, who will be making a special presentation. Congressman Towns.
Good evening. Oh, it's an honor and a pleasure to be with you this evening and to have some members of Congress who are still serving with us. And of course, I know Steve Hartford is here, and I know Bobby Scott is here. And of course, it's always a pleasure to have members of the Congressional Black Caucus to attend an NAACP convention. This congressional record was actually put together by Gregory Meeks, who is the chairman of the Political Action Committee for the Congressional Black Caucus in Washington, D.C. And I'm not going to read all of this, you know, where these there are and whereas and will be. I'm not going to do that. I'm going to spare you of all of that. But what I'd like to just say a few things as to why Gregory Meeks came to the position to present this award. And it's a congressional record where it goes everywhere. People all over the world will know about your chairperson, Rosalind Brock. They will know about her in Asia. They'll know about her in Europe. We all know about her in the United States, but we want to go just a little beyond that. And they are letting the world know about her commitment, her dedication, and determination to make this world a better place for us to live. This recognition effort was led, as said, by Greg Meeks, who chairs the Congressional Black Caucus Political Action Committee. And of course, this proclamation is to let people know and to remind them. Now, I know you would say in a proclamation about her education. Well, let me tell you about education. She has more degrees than a thermometer. And of course, her commitment and dedication, you know about that. It talks about all of that in here. And about being the youngest, you can look at it and tell about her youth. You can look at it and tell that. And then it talks about being all in for justice and equality. It talks about that. So it is my honor and my pleasure to present this congressional record. This is go on forever. It's in the record that Rosalind Brock, the chairperson of the NAACP, has done a marvelous job, not only as a chairperson, but the things that she's done in life to make the world a much better place for all of us to live. And so we join Gregory Meeks tonight in presenting this congressional record to the chair of the NAACP, Rosalind Brock.
At this time, I want to call Mrs. Hazel N. Dukes, member of the National Board of Directors, vice chair of NAACP Convention Planning, and president of the NAACP New York State Conference to come to the podium to present our keynote speaker. Following Mrs. Duke's introduction, we will hear a rendition of Jesus Will, presented by gospel recording artist Anita Wilson from East St. Louis, Illinois. Ms. Dukes.
President Brooks, Chairman Emeritus Barnes, members of the NAACP National Board of Directors, special contribution members, delegates, alternates, supporters, and friends. On this opening public meeting of the 105th NAACP National Convention, it is with much pleasure and great pride that I share some information about our opening speaker, Chairman Roslyn M. Brock. As she is one of the group of Euphra adults who are carving an escalating pathway of accomplishments and productivity as she pursues her chosen goal. She's currently employed as Vice President of Advocacy and Public Policy for Barnes Secure Health System Incorporated in Marysville, Maryland. Prior to this, she worked for 10 years in health programs at the W. Kellogg Foundation, Battle Creek, Michigan. To prepare for her career, you heard Chairman, former Congressman Ed Towns said she had more degrees than a thermometer. That's true. And I said to her, don't get any more because I was tired of traveling all over as she received degrees. First from Virginia Union, then George Washington University, then Northwestern University, and finally a Master of Divinity degree from the Samuel D. Whitt Proctor School of Theology at Virginia Union University. Coupled with these achievements, during the past 25 years, she has served the NAACP in several leadership roles, having joined the association as a freshman at Virginia Union and was elected president of the Virginia NAACP Youth and College Conference. The following year, she was elected as a youth national board member and vice chair of the National Board Health Committee. From 1999 to 2009, she served as chair of the NAACP Board Convention Planning Committee after I had prepared her for that job, producing average annual net of some $1 million. Her pathway continued as she was elected vice chair of the NAACP Board of Directors in 2001 at age 35, the youngest person and the first woman ever to be elected to this post. To help build a bridge for future leaders in 2005, she created with some other youth the Leadership 500 Summit. The summit goal is to recruit, train, and maintain a new generation of civil rights leaders for the NAACP age 30 through 50. Since its inception, Leadership 500 has contributed some $1 million to the NAACP National Treasurer. In 2010, she was elected to succeed NAACP Chairman Julian Bond as the youngest and fourth woman to serve in this post. She is recipient of numerous healthcare, community service, and leadership awards, and has been recognized by several national publications, organizations, and institutions. Her enduring pathway signpost is an African proverb: care more than others think is wise, risk more than others think is safe, dream more than others think is practical, and expect more than others think is possible. Friends, I present to you a second generation leader, one that I have helped shape and mold to grow into a phenomenal woman, a woman who can multitask, but yet stay humble as a servant, chairman of our national board of directors, Roslyn M. Brock.
Hallelujah. Come on, put your hands together if you know that Jesus will always come through for you. Come on. Does anybody know anything about Jesus tonight? Come on, make some noise for him tonight. Yeah. Whoa. Jesus will, oh,
said he will.
Delegates, to the members of the National Board of Directors of the NAACP, our Special Contribution Fund Board of Trustees, President and CEO Cornell William Brooks, our First Lady Brooks, Cornell II, and Hamilton, welcome to the NAACP. Chairman Bond, members of the national staff of the NAACP, truly, I'm blessed. I'm blessed to be with you this evening. Our president and CEO chided me that he has a boatload of folk here. His family is here with him, and we're so proud of that. But I'm proud that my family is also here tonight to support me. I'm so grateful that my mother is here. Mom, I love you, and I thank you for your steadfast love and support. My brother, Ronald Glover, thank you so much. Mama Dukes, everybody knows Mama Dukes, and I thank you so much for that very warm and gracious introduction. Let's give it up for Mama Dukes. But there's also a family called Team Brock that's here with me, and I'm so grateful that they're here. BB, I love you, and I thank you. And I'm grateful to Nicholas Wiggins, who is detailed for special programs to the events plan and office. Somebody ought to say amen. Well, very seriously, I'm here tonight, and I'm all in for justice and equality. The theme of this year's conference is inspired by our location. The city of Las Vegas, which refers to itself as the entertainment capital of the world. In Vegas, as some affectionately call it, you can find opportunities for just about anything. For shopping, for dining, for performances, and yes, even a little gambling. Our theme borrowed a phrase from the gaming industry to inspire our imagination and challenge our determination. We want our delegates here assembled to double down on their efforts to accomplish the mission of the NAACP, which is to ensure the political, educational, social, and economic equality of rights for all people, and to eliminate racial hatred and discrimination. And so we've come for the 105th time under the banner of All In for Justice and Equality. In this city, the term all in typically means wagering your entire hand gambling. But my friends, we're not here to gamble with our future, our children's future, or the future of the millions we fight for daily across this nation. Our work is serious business, and we must channel our collective energies and risk everything we have for freedom, just like those students did 50 years ago in Freedom Summer. We want to urge you to put it all on the line on behalf of those we serve, because half-hearted measures are not sufficient to solve the crisis of our time. We must be proactive and not reactive to deal with the setbacks we have experienced in recent months. My friends, we cannot continue to play defense. We have to be on the offense. Pops, wave after wave of oppression continues to come our way. But I believe tonight that we can and we will prevail. But we must understand, my friends, that victory won't come easy, and it doesn't come cheap. So to serve the present age, we have to go beyond the episodic and reactive responses to assaults on justice in our nation. Because the pressure keeps coming and coming, but the NAACP will prevail. For too long, we have waited on someone or something to ignite our fire and our passion. But now we must do as the young people say, show up, rise up, and turn up. No. We come together, or we came together last year when Trayvon Martin was murdered. We demonstrated and we wore hoodies, but his killer was acquitted, and the Stand Your Ground laws still stand their ground. These dangerous laws that make our communities more vulnerable for violence are still in force today. The pressure keeps coming, but the NAACP will prevail. We were all moved to action when 270 Nigerian girls were kidnapped by Boko Haram. We marched, we petitioned, and many of us use the hashtag #BringBackOurGirls on Twitter. But our girls have not been rescued. Girls and women still suffer from gender-based violence, from Nigeria to Nevada. Most of the world has moved on. And I submit to you tonight, my friends, that we must never forget that a tweet is no substitute for a sustained worldwide movement to demand respect for human rights, particularly for the rights of girls and women. The pressure keeps coming, but the NAACP will prevail. We protested and became enraged over the botched election of Clayton Lockett in Oklahoma this year. While we rejoice in the state where we've won victories over the death penalty, we've not yet consigned capital punishment to the ash heap of history where it belongs. The pressure keeps coming, but the NAACP will prevail. On the 60th anniversary of Brown versus the Board of Education, we renewed, Ms. Adora, our commitment to quality public education for all children. But beyond integration, my friends, education is the real goal. And so we can't continue to begrudge those who support charter schools as one approach to address the failures of the education system, because the overwhelming majority of our children are not in charter schools. They're still in neighborhood schools that deserve our time, they deserve our attention, and they deserve quality teachers, adequate facilities, enhanced resources, and the same type of education that we give to our best and our brightest in the most wealthy of neighborhoods. We must prepare our children for life in the 21st century. The pressure keeps coming, but the NAACP will prevail. In Detroit, Michigan, thousands of people had their water turned off. Hard-working citizens lost their pensions. Street lights have been turned off, leaving communities vulnerable to danger. And I ask you the question tonight, what kind of nation have we become? We must embrace the crises in Detroit, because the crisis in Detroit is not just limited to that city. This is a challenge for all Americans. Detroitans should not be treated as if their struggle is happening in a foreign land for which we have no responsibility. They are our fellow Americans, and they deserve better. Working with our friends in the labor movement, change must be brought to Detroit, because this slow motion disaster is a shame of America. The pressure keeps coming, but the NAACP will prevail. It has been more than a year since the Supreme Court undermined the Voting Rights Act, and there was a chorus of protest and dismay. But instead of the Congress responding to this tragedy by strengthening the act, more and more states are trying to assault and restrict the right to vote. That's why we're so grateful to our Attorney General, Eric Holder, who stopped Florida's Secretary of State from conducting a massive purge of voter rolls. My friends, we can, and working with our members in Congress, Bobby Scott, we will restore the Voting Rights Act. But we must unite in a national campaign to educate all of Americans about the power of their vote. Friends, we can't do this work alone, but we can never forget that this work cannot be done without us, the nation's oldest and largest civil rights organization. We must prevail in our work Because when we look at Chicago, Illinois, since the beginning of this month, Reverend Deer, close to 200 shootings have occurred, with at least 34 of them resulting in death. This year alone, 1,000 individuals have been shot in this city. These shootings are taking the lives of the next generation at alarming rates. And as Dr. Hooks used to say, is anybody listening? Does anybody care? The problems are so profound in Chicago that even an 11-year-old young girl, Shamaya Adams, lost her life because she was participating with her girlfriends in a sleepover. How do you lose your life in a sleepover? The pressure keeps coming, but the NAACP will prevail. And in the seriousness of this moment, I want you to take a minute and reflect on the life and the soul of Eric Garner, that gentle giant from Staten Island, New York, who was killed by police on Thursday. You may have seen the video on the news or online, and if you hadn't, have not, I ask you to do so. But I ask you the question, NAACP, what was Mr. Garner's crime? Allegedly, he was selling cigarettes on the street. The police used a chokehold that had been banned for more than 20 years that took his life. Pressure keeps coming, but the NAACP will prevail. The facts are that Eric Garner had just acted as a peacemaker on the streets in a dispute that the police were late to break up. And the officer's killing of Mr. Garner is a matter of a criminal investigation. And I can assure you, my friends, that Hazel Dukes and the New York State Conference, NAACP, is on the job and will not let it be swept under the rug or reduced to an internal investigation. We demand justice for Eric Garner and the kind of police reform that ensures that something like this can never, ever happen again. Pressure keeps coming, but the NAACP will prevail. Friends, when I think about all that I've shared with you tonight, I've tried to give you a glimpse of what's happening in our nation. We've been told that the NAACP is not relevant, and we're not on the ground, and we're not meeting the needs of those who need us most. But I submit to you tonight that the NAACP is relevant. We are on the ground because we are all in for justice and equality. I still have hope tonight, and I'm inspired by the theme of our convention. But I would just amend it by adding four very important words. You see, a poker player can declare himself to be all in, but our work, my friends, is too deep. Our work is too broad, and our work is too wide for just an individual perspective. Imagine with me the possibilities of an amended theme that embraces the concept that we are all in this thing together. I'm all in, he's all in, she's all in, they're all in, and we are all in this thing together. We have to leave Las Vegas with the zeal to vote in November for individuals who believe that their victory
is in fact our victory. African Americans have played and will play a critical role in the outcome of this year's election. Indeed, we already have. A prime example is recently when veteran conservative Mississippi Senator Thad Cochran appealed to the residents of Mississippi to do what? To support him in his runoff for the Republican nomination for U.S. Senator. And what did we do? We responded to that call. And the NAACP made the difference to elect someone who was really conservative over someone who was too extreme. When you think about the politics in this nation, NAACP, we must be willing to work on both sides of the aisle to get our job done. We have to be all in for justice and equality. And so together we must continue the commitment of those who have gone before us. Those stalwarts like Julian Bond and Merle Evers Williams. We must replicate the resolve of the heroes and the sheroes whose names we know and the names of those we can never call. Together, we must honor the legacy of those who have suffered, who have bled, and who have died for the cause of justice and equality. The survival of our republic truly depends on our success. The nation and the world is browning. This republic depends on our success. And so our agenda is essential. It's about the fundamental building blocks of a decent and a thriving society. And so all people need living wage jobs, affordable quality health care, excellent schools, a clean environment, safe neighborhoods, and a truly just and equitable justice system. And so I ask you tonight's delegates, no fanfare, no hoopla, it's a serious matter. And I ask you to resolve yourselves to form a more perfect union. We survived the Civil War. We survived Jim Crow. We thrived when we united together against injustice through the courts, through legal protest, and civil disobedience. And we faced many, many challenges before. And we have so much to celebrate. The pressure keeps coming. But for 105 years, the NAACP has stood strong and vibrant in the midst of controversy, in the midst of conflict. And so each of you are heirs and beneficiaries of the heroic work of our movement for more than a century. But now, my friends, it's your time. It's your time, Hamilton. It's your time, Cornell, too. It's your time. The future of this organization and this world resides in your hands. And so as we look across the landscape of this nation, I ask you, my friends, to go forth from this warm city in the desert that's burning. I want you to leave here with that same burning determination to make this year the year that you said that I went all in for justice and equality. We still believe that we can conquer anything because we've been kept by the grace of God. NAACP, we've come through worse before, but we've never ever walked alone because we understood that we've been kept by the grace of God. And so, my friends, if you remember nothing else this night, remember that the pressure keeps coming, but the NAACP will answer. The pressure keeps coming, but the NAACP will prevail. The pressure keeps coming, but courage will not skip this generation. We're all in for justice and equality. God bless you all, NAACP. The pressure is gonna come, but we're gonna keep standing. Is there anybody here who's willing to keep standing? Who's gonna stand with the NAACP? We're so grateful for your leadership and for your service. God is with us, and he will prevail.
Chairman used her superb skill to chart the path for this convention and for this association for the coming year. We have our marching orders. We have to move forward with that burning energy that she talked about. So let's really show her how we feel about her. Thank your chairman. Delegates, it is time to address the business of this convention. I call Lenita Ross, convention secretary, to come to the podium to provide the advanced credentials report. This report reflects the registration of delegates received by the national office prior to this date. Ms. Ross.
Good evening. My name is Lenita Ross. I'm the convention secretary to the NAACP 105th Annual NAACP Convention. I'll be reading the credential report. Region 1, adult voting 163, alternates 32, observer 105, count by region, 300. Region 1 youth, voting 19. Alternates 14. Observers 64. Count by region, 97. Voting region 1, total 182. Alternate, total 46. Observer, total 169. Count by region, 397. Region 2, adult 187. Alternate 21. Observer 68. Count by region, 276. Region 2 youth, 15. Alternate 2, observer 18, count by region 35, region 2 voting total 202, alternate 23, observer 86, count by region 311, region 3 adult voting 192, alternate 30, observer 92, count by region 314, region 3 youth voting 35, alternate 9, observer 13, count by region 57, region 3 voting total 227, alternate 39, observer 105, count by region 371. Region 4 adult voting 79, alternate 6, observer 20, count by region 105. Region 4 youth voting 13, alternate 6, observer 9, count by region 28. Region 4 voting total 92, alternate 12, observer 29, count by region 133. Region 5 adult voting 237, alternate 23, observer 69, count by region 329. Region 5 youth voting 29, alternate 13, observer 16, count by region 53. Region 5 total 261 voting, 36 alternate, observer 85, count by region 382. Region 6 adult voting 119, alternate 15, observer 40, count by region 174. Region 6 youth 32 voting, 15 alternate, 19 observer, count by region 66. Region 6 total voting 151, alternate 30, observer 59, count by region 240. Region 7 adult voting 83, alternate 2, observer 47, count by region 132. Region 7 youth voting 7, alternate 1, observer 9, count by region 17. Total region 7 voting is 90, alternate 3, observer 56, count by region 149. Region 9 adult at large voting 0, alternate 0, observer 35, count by region 35. Region 9, which is, I'm sorry, at large youth 0, alternate 0, observer 2, count by region 2. At large voting 0, alternate 0, observer 37, count by region 37. The grand total voting is 1,205, alternate 189, observer 626, count by region 2020. That completes the credential reports for the 105th convention.
Thank you. Heard the motion and it was properly seconded. All those in favor of the motion to receive the report will say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it. At this time, I'm going to call upon Ms. Hazel Lynn Dukes to give the rules for electing a board member at large during this convention. Ms. Dukes.
Well, all the members of the National Committee come, please, immediately. Election supervisory members, please come forward. that mean the region people until the election in your office is tomorrow? Would you please come forward? This is crucial, so I would ask that all the delegates stay in so tomorrow we can move swiftly through what we have to do. As you know, we elect a person from our delegation, you, the convention people, who are delegates. Listen carefully. Nominations, rules for electing members of the board of directors at the 105th annual convention. These persons that is standing before you will be the persons tomorrow morning that will be in this hall before 10 o'clock. That's 10 a.m., not 10 p.m. The deadline to receive consent forms for a candidate to the board of directors at the annual convention will be Monday, July the 21st, 2014, no later than 10 a.m. Only a certified voting delegate to the annual national convention may be nominated and second. Qualification. Any member in good standing of the association shall be eligible to be elected and to serve on the National Board of Directors, except a member who is, at the time of election, is an employee of the association during a two-year period prior to the date nominations are made. A member in good standing is one who has been a bona fide member at large or at branch or other units of the association for at least 30 days prior to the nominations are made. Consent forms may be turned into the election supervisory committee at the podium, following the chairman's address at the opening session of the convention on Sunday, July 20, 2014, to be considered by the committee. All consent forms must be submitted no later than 10 a.m. on Monday deadline. Members of the election supervisory committee will be at the podium in the front of the convention hall from 9 a.m. to 10 a.m. on Monday to receive consent forms and petition. Voting shall be by voting machines. Voting will commence on Tuesday, July 22, 2014, starting at 12:30 p.m. and will be closed at 5:30 p.m. that same day. If there is anyone tonight that's so moved, what is it? What is she saying? From 12:30, and it will be closed at 5:30 p.m. that same day. Is there anyone so moved to be considered tonight that you would like to be considered to be nominated to run for delegate at this convention? You may come now and present your consent forms to the members of the election supervisory committee. Anyone else feel so moved tonight to come? If not, you must be here and present it to those persons standing before 10 a.m. tomorrow. Vice Chair Lydia and the committee members, would you step aside and review that and keep that in your possession till tomorrow morning? Thank you very much. For the members of the Metropolitan Council of the New York State Conference, you must meet this afternoon after the dismissal of this session in room 2001. One in this hotel. All presidents and their delegates are to meet after the session is closed.
You mean your room is 21?
21001. You must meet.
Thank you, Ms. Dukes. The committee will be available. They will be on the front row here if other folks have petitions to provide. I have a number of announcements. You can move. I have a number of announcements to make. First, the Youth Social is in South Seas F, Ballroom South Seas F, which is on the third floor of this building. Also, gospel recording artist Anita Wilson will be available in the Convention Center for signings of her new album, Vintage Worship. The Joint NAACP International Affairs and LGBT Task Force will meet Wednesday from 2:30 to 4:30 p.m. in room Breakers D on the second floor of this convention center. We would remind you that the convention is being live streamed on the NAACP website, and we invite you to call your neighbors and friends at home and have them watch what's going on. I would also remind you that on Wednesday morning, we will be joined by Vice President Joseph Biden. This will require that all attendees must go through magnetometers for security purposes. Therefore, we are requesting that delegates and observers limit what you bring with you into the hall. Please leave your bags, your backpacks, your briefcases, and all other unnecessary items in your rooms, because we will be starting the process at 7:30 a.m. We need you to be here early in order to get 3,000 people through magnetometers. We need you to start lining up at 7:30 to enter the room, and because of that, we would remind you to eat something before you come. Take your necessary medications and make any other preparation that you need to make, because you will be in this room until the Vice President leaves. That's forewarning. We will open the hall at 7:30 a.m. and begin the magnetometer process at that time, and we would appreciate your full cooperation in order to secure the facility. Now, the Pennsylvania State Conference Caucus meeting will be in the back of this room at the dismissal of this program. They will meet on the left-hand side. I'm assuming they mean the stage left-hand side of the room. Immediately following this meeting, Pennsylvania State Conference. Region 5 leadership are asked to caucus at 9 p.m. in room 61325 in the Mandalay Bay Hotel. Region 5 leadership are asked to caucus at 9 p.m. in room 61325 in the Mandalay Hotel. Ladies and gentlemen, will you give your attention to Reverend Don Burse as he returns to the podium to provide a benediction for this evening's program. Reverend Burse.
We're all standing. Nobody told me when I first came here that this was almost like a church setting. And to have a young lady, the chairperson, get up and talk like that, I thought she was gonna hoop for a little bit. Grab the hand of the person next to you. Father, we bless you for this night. I thank and praise you for everything that has been said and done. Lord God, I've been moved tonight, but by the very words that we're all in. Lord, we thank you for what you're going to do this week. You said you would not withhold any good thing from us. So we're going to praise you in advance like you've already done it. Now, Lord God, as we leave this place, knowing that we're never out of your presence, we pray you keep us. Because if you keep us, we've been kept. If you hold us, we've been held. If you love us, we've been loved. Now, God, I take authority over every foul spirit that may try to creep in this week. Every negative word, I rebuke you now. This is going to be a good convention. Someone's going to be empowered. Someone's going to be strengthened. And God, you get all the glory. Now do me a favor, look at your neighbor. Say, neighbor, I love you. And there's nothing you can do about it. God bless you. You're dismissed.